for all the things we have done and left undone. For all the things we have done and left undone.
You to this evening service on Ash Wednesday. My prayer is that you will find God's Spirit touching yours tonight as we begin the season of Lent. I welcome you to this house of worship and the sanctuary of God's presence. Would you rise as you are able for our first hymn?
Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to God who is in secret. And God, who sees in secret, will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. For truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by God who is in secret. And God, who sees in secret, will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal.
And in essence, what he's saying is, don't shout out in bold and really obnoxious ways your faith. Now that seems a little weird, doesn't it? What Jesus saw was people who if you listen carefully, forever he used the word hypocrites. He was saying those folks are hypocrites who make a big show of their religion or their spirituality. They make a big show of it. They want everybody to know how wonderful they are. Do you ever meet anybody like that? Sometimes when I go to Rays games and they're just getting ready to get started up again. We've got tickets. There's a guy on a street corner outside, and he's shouting scripture and all other kinds of stuff at whoever passes by. You know, sort of acting as if, I think, in my opinion, he's saved, we're not. And we need to get on his bandwagon in order to get right with God. Have you ever met anybody like that?
Yes.
Got any in your families?
Yes.
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 Yes, indeed. But Jesus is saying it's not about making a big show of your religion or your spirituality. I think what he's saying is that it's in the quiet things. In the quiet things that we do. in the simple things that we say. In the quiet ways we seek to live out our faith, that's what matters. Because when we know that what we're doing comes from a God place, God sees that too. Somebody was traveling from the city one time out into the country, and the signs on the road weren't very good, and so he got a little lost, and he stopped along the way as he saw a farmer along the road, and he asked directions. Now, we know this must have been a woman driver. And I know it wasn't me, because I don't stop and ask for directions, but anyway. And he asked, "Can you tell me how far it is to the town of Mill Pond?" "Well," said the farmer, "the way you're going, it's about 24,996 miles. But if you turn around, it's about 4. And there's a lesson in there for us. We sometimes will take off like bats out of hell in one direction, thinking that we're just going right. Off we go. And we go down some road and we keep going and we keep going and we keep going. And we suddenly realize that we are just totally lost. All we got to do is turn around. Turn around. That's what the word repentance is about, and it's part of what we do on Ash Wednesday. We take a look at those ways in which our lives have been either out of control or going in the wrong direction really fast or really slow. But we just know that they're going in the wrong direction. We know that there are things in our lives that we should change because God's Spirit has been nudging us and nudging us. And Ash Wednesday and the season of Lent is that time when we have an opportunity to turn around and get going in the right direction. Not with great show, because that's not what the gospel says, but quietly. I also think it's really wonderful in some ways that this Lenten season has started so close to the close of Advent and Christmas, and so close to January 1st. What do we do on January 1st? We make all kinds of resolutions, don't we? Here we are in mid-February. How are we doing? Now, if you took on some of those religions in January knowing that they were about repenting, turning in the right direction, you have another whole opportunity to start again. Isn't that great? What are those things that you started out doing, but, oh, here we are in mid-February, and you already know you're not there. I hear some quiet amens. You have an opportunity to start anew. To start anew. I'm not saying that it's easy to live a spiritual life. It's about turning away and turning toward God, turning away from the stuff that's not of God, turning toward the things that are of God. I'm not saying that it's about shouting out in the street corners your faith. It's none of that. It's quietly setting our hearts and our spirits in the right direction. The direction that we know God would have us go. And it's not easy. This evening we're going to be, for those of you who desire to, we're going to be putting ashes on your forehead. And we do so with the word, "As dust you are, and to dust you shall return." It is a reminder of our mortality. Amen. Of our mortality. For me, through all of these years, it has been an interesting experience to participate in this. As a pastor. To year after year come to this night, and to know that as I mark your foreheads and say those words over you, I don't know whether you're going to be here next year or not. I don't know whether I will be here next year or not. And for me, that's an incredible experience, that sense of our mortality, being in God's hands, not our own. spiritual life is not an easy one. It has us face up to those things in our lives which we know we should change. I found somewhere in one of the commentaries on this particular scripture these words. Did you know that one of the most beautiful, and it's interesting, tomorrow's what, Valentine's Day? Did you know that one of the most beautiful and cherished items in all the world, a diamond, is nothing more than carbon dust, ashes, in other words, that have been exposed to pressure. They've been exposed to pressure. Remember the pictures of Superman, you know? So our Lenten season is an opportunity for us to change. It's an opportunity for us to maybe enter into a time of pressure, but a spiritual pressure from God that will form us and make us into something more beautiful than you already are. It's never easy feeling that pressure. But I know that life is better because of it. So I hope in this season of Lent, you remind yourselves often of who you are. You and I, we are mortal human beings, just trying to get through life as best we can with God's help. You and I are mortal human beings trying to find the ways in which God would use us in the world. Not to shout from the housetops, but in the simple living of our lives to show who we belong to. That we belong to Christ, who loved us beyond measure. If we can share even just a little bit of that love in our living, what a difference the world would be. So in this season, my prayer for all of us is that we will not back down, that we will not give up, but as each new day begins, we will be reminded of who we are and how God is calling us to live out our spiritual lives in the world, day by day. Would you pray? God, we bless you and we thank you for the words of Jesus, who in his own really quiet way went about sharing your love. But he did it in such a beautiful way that crowds were drawn to him. And we ourselves even continue to come to him and find in him love. So as we begin this season, Lent, remind us daily that we are yours. And help us to seek that path through life which will guide us into life eternal. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. I'm going to ask Brad and Susie to join me as we begin to dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection, and it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration there would be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. During this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism, and they did that early on Easter morning. It was also a time when persons who had committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness and restored to participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the need we all have to renew our faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word, to make a right beginning of repentance and as a mark of our mortal day of nature, let us bow ourselves before our Creator and Redeemer. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes which we will wear this night may be to us a sign of our mortality and penitence, so that we may remember that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. Amen. I invite you, as you feel ready, to come forward for the imposition of ashes. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Create in me a clean heart and put a new and right spirit within me.
I know my transgressions, and my transgressions are ever before me. Against you and you alone have I sinned and done what is wrong in your sight, so that you are justified in your verdict and blameless when you pass judgment.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Create in me a clean heart and put a new and right spirit within me.
I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be purer than the snow.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Create in me a clean heart, and put a new and right spirit within me.
Let me hear joy and gladness. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Create in me a clean heart, and put a new and right spirit within me.
May the Almighty and merciful God, who desires not the death of the sinner, but that we turn from wickedness and live, accept your repentance and mine. Forgive us our sins, and restore us by the Holy Spirit to newness of life. Amen.
Thank you.
community churches, everyone will be welcome at this table. You do not need to be a member of this church or any church. Simply have a desire in your heart to come closer to the God of your understanding. God be with you.
Also with you.
Open your hearts.
Open them to God.
Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give God thanks for grace.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give you thanks, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust of the earth you formed us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. When you gave us your only Son, Jesus Christ, your Spirit led him into the wilderness where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights in preparation for his ministry. Now, as we enter this Lenten season, you lead us to repentance for our sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during these 40 days of Lent, we may become prepared to renew our covenant of love with you. We ask that you send the power of the Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this cup, we may know the presence of the living Christ.
Amen.
Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Therefore, we proclaim our faith, that Christ has died,
Christ has risen, Christ is here,
and Christ will come again.
Jesus was a humble man, a humble servant. He was the Son of God, and yet even he knew his mortality. He even knew that from dust he had come, to dust he was going to return. But it was not going to be forever. That night that he gathered with his friends for that meal, he took an element that came from grain, that came from the dust of the earth, and he took it, and he blessed it, and then he broke it. And he's saying, this is my body that is going to be broken for you. That there may be times in your life that you will recognize your own mortality. There will be times in your life that you will recognize that not everybody gets out of life alive. But know that I will be with you from the time that you come from dust to the time that you shall return. I will be with you. So do this in remembrance of me. And then he took a cup and it was filled with fruit of the vine. Again, fruit from dust and dirt. And he blessed it and he passed it around. And he said, this is a cup. This is a new covenant. My blood, my spirit, my flesh, all of who I am will be poured into this cup so that you will know the true meaning of life. And that even though that you will return to dust one day, not all of it is lost. For there is a reunion day. So when you do this, when you drink from this cup, do this in remembrance of me. And so now come, the table has been prepared, and God is present.
Thank you.
Amen.